The last video focuses on kind of what happens in the absence of those kinds of processes and introduces the concept of toxic stress.
Learning to deal with stress is an important part of healthy development. When experiencing stress, the stress response system is activated. The body and brain go on alert. There's an adrenaline rush, increased heart rate, and an increase in stress hormone levels. When the stress is relieved after a short time, or a young child receives support from caring adults, the stress response winds down and the body quickly returns to normal. In severe situations, such as ongoing abuse and neglect, where there is no caring adult to act as a buffer against the stress response stays activated. Even when there is no apparent physical harm, the extended absence of response from adults can activate the stress response system. Constant activation of the stress response overloads developing systems with serious, lifelong consequences for the child. This is known as toxic stress. Over time, this results in a stress response system set permanently on high alert. In the areas of the brain dedicated to learning and reasoning, the neural connections that comprise brain architecture are weaker and fewer in number. Science shows that the prolonged activation of stress hormones in early childhood can actually reduce neural connections in these important areas of the brain at just the time when they should be growing new ones. Toxic stress can be avoided if we ensure that the environments in which children grow and develop are nurturing, stable, and engaging.
Okay, so just to synopsize, experiences are critical, especially in the early years of life, in shaping brain architecture. Serve and return is an especially important process in the context of families in promoting healthy brain development and in the development of healthy neural circuitry. And in the absence of those kinds of healthy experiences, including serve and return, children can experience toxic stress, which can have long-lasting effects on the development of neural circuitry. Okay, this is another computer task. This time you guys don't have to do it. I'm just gonna show you how it was done. So we were also interested in executive functioning, as I've mentioned. And this is a task that actually was developed by Jen Martin McDermott and her graduate advisor, Nathan Fox, when she was at the University of Maryland. She's now here at UMass. This is called a flanker task. The original version was developed for adults, so Jen's work was to adapt it for children. The task involves the following. We tell people they're gonna be looking at a computer screen and a white dot is gonna come on the screen right in the middle. And they have a button box that has a green or a red button. And after the white dot comes on, then a series of colored circles comes on and they have to push the button that's the same color as the circle right here that's above the white dot. Okay, so in this case, pretty easy because everything's green. In this case, pretty easy because everything's red. It's much more difficult when what you have is a green circle in the middle, but it's surrounded by red circles because you have to screen out the red and there's a predominance of red, right? So these flankers, the things that flank the middle circle, can make the task more challenging. And the other thing that you can see is that after the children made a response, we let them know whether they were getting the response correct or not. We had either a smiley face come on the screen or a frowny face came on the screen, and that let them know whether they'd done a good job or not. What we were interested in is the electrical activity, and remember I was talking about EEG and ERP, the electrical activity that we saw at various points on the scalp after the children made a response, and in particular after they made an incorrect response and got the feedback in the form of a frowny face that they'd made a mistake. So instead of you having to do this, we can call on my friend Andrew here. He's a friend of our family who's demonstrating the task for you. So you can see he has the electrode cap on here. He's looking at a computer screen. You see the colored circles coming on and the response that he's getting, whether he gets it right or wrong. So we have them do that for some period of time and a lot of responses, and then we look at the incorrect responses and the amount of electrical activity that we're seeing in response to the incorrect responses when there's feedback. Now, what we noticed was that in typical individuals, when they're doing this and they make a mistake, we see an increase in the amount of electrical activity in this area in the front of the brain when they make a mistake and they get the feedback that they've made that mistake. But in the context of kids who've had these adverse experiences, when they make a mistake and get feedback, we didn't see the same increase in electrical activity in that area in the brain. Now think about what that might mean in terms of children's ability to do well. And so this is one of the ways that you can map on kind of some of the brain stuff to some of the challenges that we see. So your child, you're in a classroom, you're doing things you're not supposed to do, the teacher's trying to cue you, you're supposed to raise your hand and not blurt answers out, but you're not picking up that corrective feedback. There's not any kind of increase in the particular area of the brain that's supposed to help you change direction and make plans when you're making that mistake or getting feedback. Or you're on the playground and you're playing with peers and instead of like asking for a turn, you grab something and they start looking at you in an annoyed way. But you're not picking up on that. So the signal's not getting through. Now, a lot of our programs are based on, well, let's just give the child information, let's just tell them what they need to do more. But if the signal's not getting through, then the ability of the child to benefit from that kind of information is going to be really limited. So we need, in those contexts, to be much more thoughtful about how we deliver services and support to children who are like that in the context of interventions. But the good news is that when we do that, so for instance, in several of our programs, we've looked at what happens to kids who are receiving that kind of support over time. And what we found is, so this is sort of like the typical response to corrective feedback is an increase in electrical activity. And in kids who come from adverse backgrounds, we see very little increase in electrical activity after they make mistakes. But once kids who've had this pattern get into really responsive, kind of good serve and return environments, then when they make mistakes and get feedback, we see this response that looks much more like a typical response. Does that make sense? So we're really seeing the ability to reverse some of these effects if we put the right conditions in place. And I think that's a really important take-home message, that these effects, even though they map on to particular kinds of early experiences and they're detectable in terms of changes in the brain, they don't necessarily mean that they're permanent changes. There's a lot of plasticity in these systems, and the right circumstances, especially if we're precise and targeted enough, really have the potential to make breakthrough kinds of changes in the not only the child's kind of way that they function in their daily environment, but also at the level of the brain. So don't